Please stand.
You are
those who believe in you. Now we implore you with the fragrance of this incense to pardon those who have done wrong, guide those who have gone astray, perfect those who are righteous, and purify those who have sinned. Be a father to orphans and care for the widows. Feed the poor, dispel all doubts, comfort the sorrowful. Soften those who have hardened their hearts, and fill oppressors with compassion. Satisfy the hungry, assist the distressed, and accept those who repent. May we and all the faithful departed, our fathers and mothers, brothers and sisters, and our leaders believe in you and rejoice in your kingdom. We raise glory and thanks and adoration to you forever.
Thank you. Glory to the Lord of all and the apostles. May the mercy of God descend upon the reader and the listeners, and upon this parish and her children forever.
Brothers and sisters, so that you may not claim to be wiser than you are, I want you to understand this mystery. A hardening has come upon part of Israel until the full number of the Gentiles has come in, and so all Israel will be saved. As it is written, out of Zion will come the Deliverer. He will banish ungodliness from Jacob, and this is my covenant with them when I take away their sins. As regards the gospel, they are enemies of God for your sake. But as regards election, they are beloved for the sake of their ancestors. For the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. Just as you were once disobedient to God, but have now received mercy because of their disobedience, so they have now been disobedient in order that, by the mercy shown to you, they too may now receive mercy. For God has imprisoned all the disobedience so that he may be merciful to all. Oh, the depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God! How unsearchable are his judgments, and how inscrutable his ways! For who has known the mind of the Lord? Who has been his counselor? Or who has given a gift to him to receive a gift in return? For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen.
Praise be to God always.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
From the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to St. Matthew, who proclaimed life to the world, let us listen to the proclamation of life and salvation for our souls.
Remain silent, O listeners, for the Holy Gospel is about to be proclaimed to you. Listen and give glory and thanks to the Word of the living God.
The apostle writes, the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always, to the end of the age. This is the truth, peace be with you.
Praise and blessings to Jesus Christ, our Lord and God, for giving us his words of life. Praise and blessings to Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Christianity, but it's also very complicated and very difficult to understand, and no matter how We try to explain it, it still remains a little bit fuzzy in how to best understand it accurately. And the best way, at least how I approach it is that the love of God, as complex as it is supposed to be understood in absolute simplicity. And yet when you try to describe simplicity, then you wind up having all kinds of words to use. St. Patrick is known for holding up the shamrock, the three leaflets representing the Trinity, and saying that the shamrock, in order to be a shamrock, has to have the three leaves. And there is three leaflets, but you have to have three of them to be the shamrock. I found it very interesting when I was transferred to St. Michael's, my first parish, that it used to be St. Patrick's Roman Rite Church. And when they had outgrown it, they had just kept it as a little chapel. And they had changed it to St. Michael's so it would not be confused with St. Patrick's. And then later on, Bishop Waters gave it to the Maronite community there. And Father Joe Thomas, some of you might remember him, he came here and did a retreat for us twice. He thought, it's time that St. Patrick becomes a Lebanese. So he took the shamrock out of his hand, it was stained glass, he took the stained glass out of there and had somebody put in a Maronite cross. So we had the same symbol. If you've ever noticed, you know, when you enter from Front Street, there's the Maronite cross there with the three bars and then the vertical bar. Many of us wear a cross that has the three bars. I have one on. And I have a lapel. And during Lent, I bless the congregation with the Maronite cross, the Antiochene cross with the three bars. That the role of the Trinity is for us to feel we have a relationship with God, a relationship. It's not a distant God that lives some far out in the universe and just has a glancing view of us, created something and then left it to just go as it please. It's a relational relationship with us, with the Maronite cross, or you can use the shamrock as your symbol. With the Maronite cross, you have the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and then it has the us going through vertically to transcend up into heaven. That the identifying factor of God is love, but it's not separate from us. The whole reason for us to exist, some of us might remember the Baltimore Catechism, why we're recreated to know, love, and serve Him. It also represents the Pope, the Patriarch, and the Bishop, and the congregation. And the leaves on the end represent both trees. The tree that bore the fruit that Adam and Eve ate from and brought sin into the world. And also the wood, the tree, that Jesus died on to bring life to the world again. So there's a lot of symbols that can be used. When I was in the seminary, I talked about the Trinity starting with Genesis. That if you have read the book of Genesis, they use the plural are, making it sound like there's more than just one being involved. We can't say there were several gods that were involved in bringing the world and creation and what is visible and invisible into existence. But it is interesting that it uses a plural word. It never began to be fully understood until Jesus came and slowly began to reveal his divine nature as being the Son of God. But in every relationship, there is a speaker, somebody who is speaking. And then there is the Word. You know, the first chapter of John, the Word was with God, and the Word became flesh. That Jesus is the Word spoken by the Father. And the Holy Spirit is what we hear, and in the manner that we will believe it. Just knowing that the Father speaks, just knowing that Jesus is the Word and the words that he has given us to live by, doesn't make us believers. There's a whole lot of people who know different parts and quotes from the scriptures, but that doesn't make them a believer. I find fascinating in this gospel that the apostles who saw him, they worshiped him. And then it says, but some doubted. I find that incredibly fascinating that they would want to include that. You know, you mean those people who doubt? And as I've said 100,000 times, the scriptures isn't written for people who are absolutely perfect, who are already in heaven, and the perfect nature of God is already known and understood. It's written for us who at different times struggle, can't figure out what God is up to. It seems like a mystery, and it is a mystery. Why this? Why that? That we are asked to believe and follow and trust him, even when none of us can be the perfect example of who Jesus Christ is. Now, there are many people through the centuries that mirror in such a way that make it easier. We call them the saints. You know, all who have entered heaven are saints, and all could be included in them, but we're talking about with a capital S, those that through history were truly deeply known as mirroring the love of God. And all of this returns back to where we started. The Father. Who does he want to speak to? In the book of Genesis, he walked in the cool of the evening with Adam and Eve. Now, in Hebrew and Aramaic and other languages, Adam isn't a name of a person, and it means man. And so if we want to really understand the intentions here, God's first plan was to walk with you and me, men and women, in the coolness of the evening, talking and expressing himself. And it's all in relationship to how much he loves us. We had the example when we had the reading from the Emmaus, when the men said, weren't our hearts burning on fire? We have Jesus, well, what was he saying? He said things like this, woman, you are healed. Get up and walk. Can you see? Are you hurting? Were you arguing? Do you not understand? Are you going with me? Listen to this. Truly, truly, I say unto you, do this no more. Your faith has healed you. As the love between the Father, and the Father loves me, and I love the Father, live in my love. All of his words are to guide us, to strengthen us, to encourage us, to not attack us when we are in doubt, not to humiliate us, Even though sometimes we are very good at humiliating ourselves and humiliating others, driving some to commit suicide, rhetoric out there that can convince people that they are serving God when they kill and maim and behead. Pope Francis says very accurately, this is blasphemy against God. Hatred, rejection. The voice of the Master, the Word made flesh, the sharing of the Spirit is just like it says in our prayers today. God is like a father for those who are orphaned, and maybe not physically orphaned, but maybe psychologically orphaned and spiritually orphaned. Maybe the father was cruel, always had something negative to say, always convincing the other person he can control them by humiliating them and degrading them. He offers this image to give us a new father. Again, the voice of the Trinity, as the prayers so beautifully say, and we implore you, guide those who have gone astray. Not jab them and stab them in the back, but guide them. Pardon those who do wrong. Not spending all the energy you can possibly do to see how you can humiliate them and punish them. Sometimes there is punishment because we do have to protect ourselves, but I think you know what I mean. Purify those who have sinned. The voice, the Word, the Spirit, feed the poor. Dispel all doubts. Comfort the sorrowful. Soften those who have hardened their hearts and fill oppressors with compassion. How radical can any voice be? A lot of the evil that happens in the world happens because we become indifferent to the power of the Holy Spirit. We're not willing to listen any longer. It's not important to be able to make the effort to play and allow the Holy Spirit to use His power to sanctify our lives. If we all become individualistic in everything we believe, then there isn't any force and any power to hold back the evils of the world. The Holy Spirit, the unity of the Trinity, it works together to build us up, to reduce the amount of reasons and circumstances in which the voice of evil can expand and explode, to keep us from turning in on ourselves and be motivated by the voice of trying to scare us into doing everything, instead of knowing that the only thing that changes the world truly for the better is the love of God. And it isn't some form of wishy-washy, demanding nothing kind of love. It is confrontational love. Parents don't like to discipline their children, but they know, and I can remember, my parents never had to say this, but I heard other parents say this, you know, it hurts me more than you, but you probably heard the same thing. And so there is this agony within God, even though He doesn't really feel like us, but he understands it in a way that we could never comprehend. But think about it. When are you hurt the most? When it seems like your love is being ignored, indifferent, rejected, not being paid attention to. And we can put those human characteristics onto God because it was his idea to identify in the words that we use for father, son, for mother, daughter, the love. He has called us to hear what he has to say and to live it. And even though it may seem like it might be a burden at times, it's actually the opposite. There's this song that we used to sing, burdens are lifted at Calvary. Very profound, very beautiful. Because within our suffering, we have to look how it can be sanctifying us. And here we have, once again, returning to the cross. All together, the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, Pope, Patriarch, Bishop, and Congregation, all intimately connected. The wood that brought death into the world and the wood that brings life into the world. It's all put together. And in some mysterious ways, that mystery's in each and every one of us. A little bit of a doubt, maybe a lot of faith. Maybe hard-hearted in some areas, but a softy in another. And the Holy Spirit's there to mix it all together and add beautiful colors to our spirit. And what do we come out as when we walk with him? A temple. A temple of the Holy Spirit. A temple of compassion. A heart that is softened.
Consubstantial of the Father, through him all things were made, for us
Peace to you all, priests of God. grace of the only begotten Son, in the communion drawn of the Holy Spirit, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your spirit.
Forgive our sins, pardon us, and have mercy on us.
For this your repentant church implores you through and with you, implores your Father, saying,
praise Him on that last day,
and in your mercy forgive their sins. Through our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ, who is without sin, we hope to find mercy and forgiveness for our sins and for theirs.
Grant us, O God, to be pardoned, and forgive the sins we have committed, with or without full knowledge.
Grant us pardon, O God, and forgive us and the departed, so that your blessed name may be glorified in us and in all things, with the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and of your living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
As it was, it is now, shall be forever. Amen.
O Lover of all people, have mercy on us.
Have mercy on us, O Lord, O compassionate and merciful One. O Lover of all people, have mercy on us. You may be seated.
The holy icon, may your prayers for vocations to the Maronite priesthood be answered and for religious life. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.
Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.
Amen.